It must be Wednesday. That's the pan and zoom multi special effects. I don't know, but my audio is sounding kind of funky today because it's coming out of two speakers. So I guess it just is a special day today for me. Good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm great. Somebody let me know if there's any feedback because, man, you guys are loud coming out my end, but I can't do anything about it. So that's
all okay. Right. Well, no feedback so far. So we'll see how it goes.
Hey, we got a great guest today. Who's our guest today, Chris?
Who is our guest today, Brent? There's a joke going. I don't know. I just feel like sometimes we just do the same kind of thing. So I thought I'd shake things up a little bit today.
And make the presenter feel like you have no idea who's here today. Love it.
How did I get involved with these nuts? Anyway.
This is two guys. Come on. Carla Torgerson here today. Good morning.
Good morning, everyone.
Hello.
Hey, Chris.
Excellent. And Mike is confirming in the that there's no feedback on his side. So that's good to know as we always kind of puzzle through some of the strange technical things that sometimes come up. Carla, how's your day going so far?
It's going well, thanks.
Very cool.
I've already reviewed a transcript for a couple of different explainers. So I'm fired up already today.
There we go. It's the coffee. It helps.
Absolutely, right?
No kidding.
Hey, everybody has a better day after watching a little Idiotic. You know, that's what we always say here. So you guys can all, everybody in the chat, you can expect to have a much better day today.
Honest, trust us.
We're talking about microlearning today because you've got a book. We'll just jump right in and go to the promo and say, hey, she's got a book, people. Get out there.
Well, thanks, Brent and Chris, for having me. Yeah, we just launched the book. It hit Amazon around a month ago. It's called Designing Microlearning, and it's from ATD Press. So it's one of those, you know, it was a year-long journey, but everyone just sees the cover now. So yeah, hope everybody enjoys it, and it's available finally.
Very cool. And we'll share a link to it as we go along here. You've got that sort of stashed up if people are looking. So not surprisingly, since the book is about designing microlearning, today's topic, we're going to talk about microlearning. Ooh. Sorry, Brent, is there an echo?
Oh, my, I hope not. Anyway. That's why we're going to keep the show short today, because we want to stick with the topic.
So. Yeah.
Nope, just kidding.
It's a 3-minute episode, and we've done a minute and a half already. So
we're done.
Thanks, everyone, for coming.
But we've talked about microlearning before, but when I was chatting with Carla about this, we were talking about, you know, what can we do that's a little bit different, a little bit, let's take the conversation to the next level of microlearning that maybe hasn't been discussed yet, that she has been starting to talk more about. Actually, it's part of the big picture of microlearning that she discusses, but since we only normally go 30 to 40 minutes here, I thought we'd pick one chunk that we haven't done before. In the past, we've talked about what the heck is microlearning. Now we're going to move on to, because everybody normally talks about video, but we're going to talk about five formats today, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Five different ways that you, five different formats that you can go use in microlearning. And in fact, drumroll please, we're going to combine that with the four uses of microlearning and show you 20 ways you can go micro today.
Wow. Well, we better get started then, or else we're going to run out of time. 20 different ways. Holy smokes. And you've got some killer visuals for us. Let's go ahead and jump in and use those, because those are just great.
Sure. Yeah. I'll go ahead. I'll present it quickly, but I know that's not the format for Idiotic, so I'll do that sort of quick, and then we'll have some conversation about it as well.
Sounds
well,
good.
You know, the fun thing about Idiotic is you can talk when the slides are up too. So we can like mix it all together. It's fantastic technology.
It's beautiful.
It's like all a whole multimedia experience, really, what we've got going on here.
We try.
All right. I am sharing. Hold tight here. Are you seeing my PowerPoint screen now?
We are now.
Yes, we are. Looking good.
Awesome. So yeah, so everybody, it's great to be here. I'm super excited to be here, and I've seen some names I already know in the chat. So thanks for everyone coming today. And like I said, many of you who follow my work, you know I talk about the four uses of microlearning. So just kind of set it up, I'll share those first. And the four ways you can use microlearning are these. The first one is preparation. So anything that comes before longer form instruction, right? So I'll share the common names for them in just a minute, but anything before longer form instruction. And then obviously anything that comes after longer form instruction, follow up to that, right? And then there's also the standalone microlearning, the things that you can do that stand on their own, and then support resources. And for me, this is really the key here, because we say we're all going micro, but we say different things, and we're doing different things, and this is where it gets muddy. So I'll show you guys the common terms we all use for these, and then we'll stop and chat. So the first one, preparation, we call it pre-work. It's been around forever, right?
Yep.
Follow-up often is called boost learning. Standalone, I like to call it short-form learning because I still haven't come up with a better name. And then performance support. And so, Brent, you and I have had interesting conversation about this just because there's like I said, there are so many people saying they're going micro, but they're doing different things. And it gets so muddied because we haven't thought about it in these ways before.
And a lot of the negative Nellies out there who like to, kind of focus on the negative side of things will tell you that, well, isn't this just performance support? And that's what I love about that slide and setting up our conversation about the formats this way first, because I think this centralizes and tells everybody, hey, listen, you know, we're all on the same page here. We're using different words. You can use the micro learning format in all of these different ways, and performance support is one of them that indeed people
are using. Absolutely, right? Yeah, it's one of them. But again, when you say everybody says it's performance support, which I hear all the time, then I think, well, what about all those people who are talking about boost learning? Because there are a lot of them, right? And what about those people who are talking about, quiz engines that give you questions, say, at the start of shift, like QStream or Axonify? They're calling that microlearning, and it is.
And how do you blend it into your instructional design? Because a lot of times instructional design gets those conversations get separated from the performance support conversation, right? And we're bringing all those worlds together with microlearning.
Yeah. And you know, Brent, you and I had talked many times before. And one of the things for me that's so exciting about microlearning is not that it's anything new, because it's not. It's all the stuff we've been talking about and doing for a long time. But the beauty and why I get so excited about this stuff is that we're going to start talking about performance support and just-in-time training more often. It's not going to be this add-on that we develop the class and then we think, oh, wouldn't a job aid be really helpful here?
Now what do we do?
Right. And if we're really thinking about how people are going to use this in the job, and they're really focused on, and we're really focused on their use case, what would they find useful and valuable? And we think about those four different ways that we can go micro, then I think we provide much more value for our learners.
I think it's also an opportunity to tie into making sure that we're focused on what people need to actually do as the result of something that we're either creating or providing, because we do often, that's always there in a sense, but often you're starting out from what do they need to know? And we've talked lots about the difference between, you know, guiding people towards performance change or improvement, et cetera, or doing, as opposed to knowing things, but whether that actually leads to performance improvements, et cetera, as well.
And that's where performance support obviously makes such a huge difference, right? And I'm such a massive fan of folks like Bob Mosier and Con Godfredson, who have really spent their careers working on that space. Yeah.
Yep, for sure.
Well, let's jump in and let's look at some formats.
Sure. All right. As promised, right? So that's your setup, right? That's your four different ways you can go micro. Now, let me just... wrong screen. I'm like all tabbing way too fast for my computer here. Okay, share that screen. And there it goes. And you should be seeing that screen again. Is that right?
Yes, got it.
Yep, but we didn't minimize. Or at least I'm not seeing us minimized in the bottom corner. Brett, are you seeing us minimized?
I am minimized, yes.
Okay, then. There we go.
Excellent. In our workshop here about micro learning, you guys are going, micro. Okay, I just couldn't help myself. All right. So obviously we talked about the four different uses of micro learning, but then what gets me excited also is thinking about the five formats of micro learning. And for me, you know, as Brent mentioned at the start of this webcast, a lot of people talk about video, right? Video, it's all video, but it's not. And for me, there's actually five formats. The first one is text-based resources. And again, this starts leaning heavily into that performance support space. But I do believe that anything that you need to reference or review at key times, text-based resources make a huge difference. And we often overlook those. Then there's the e-learning. Yeah, did you want to say something, Brent?
I was just going to throw in that we think of text-based as being, you know, primitive and simple. But if you're in a position where you have to do to read something and then perform something, having text is actually an improvement over video because you don't have to keep trying to slide around, et cetera. You know,
yeah. So
simplicity in that kind of thing reduces the cognitive load and makes things smoother.
Absolutely, Chris. You're preaching to the choir. You know, I often talk about the ability to self-pace. Yeah. And the idea of the text-based resource is that it is the most able to self-pace. And for the longest time when we were doing e-learning that didn't have voiceovers, we used to talk about how self-pacing was the value that people could control the pace. They could pause when they needed and, you know, and really take it in without that cognitive overload issue that you were mentioning as well. Now we've added voiceovers and stuff like that. So we started to erode there. But the text-based resource is your classic, right? You need to figure out how to fill out a form. Being able to go side by side through the form with the little bubbles reminding you how to do each part of it is going to make sense, right? Yeah. So there you go. Text-based resources. The next one is e-learning. That is obviously that's the space I've spent probably the majority of my career in, is interactive and engaging e-learning. And there is no reason that we can't go shorter. Right? We can do short explainer videos or like animations, right? Or we can do interactive pieces. You know, I did one not that long ago about compliance, and it was, you know, of course the client thought they needed 30 minutes of compliance training, and we were able to get it down to, I wanted 5, we made it to 8, but still short form, still be interactive, still all those things we cherish about e-learning.
I think one way, before we move on to the third one, I always need to add this in when I'm having conversations with folks, because I start to realize that there's a design side of this conversation, and then there is the development and the technical side of this conversation. And nobody's jumping into the chat to say it, but I'm sure there's some people scratching their heads with this number two e-learning one. And when you say things like there's animations and things like that, I always get the feedback from folks, and they say, well, why that's not e-learning then? That's just a video, or that's just an animation. Sure. That's just a thing. And the point I try to make with folks is that when we say words like e-learning, and maybe this isn't the way that you approach it, for me, this is, we can turn that short animation or that micro learning moment, and maybe it does or doesn't have some interactivity to it, but into a SCORM package that can fit in your LMS and it can be tracked. To me, that's what that means. So whether it's, you could have just a video, absolutely. And I don't mean just a video as people tell me as a negative thing, it's a positive thing. But when you put it inside a SCORM wrapper, then you're able to upload it into your LMS and to the rest of the world, that then becomes e-learning because it can land inside your LMS. So it's a semantics thing, but it's important to understand that that tech part is really what changes the naming convention and makes people happy to just say, "Ooh, we have e-learning," when maybe they just have a video.
Yeah. I think there's an opportunity, you know, here as well to make sure that whatever you're providing to people is an opportunity for practice as well. It's not simply pushing information, that maybe, you know, there's an application aspect to it as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. And Brent, I love your comment there about, you know, if it's a SCORM package, let's call it e-learning. Because I love that, because I too get that often, of especially the combination of this and the next one, which is video, right? Yeah. So, well, I could put a video in my e-learning piece. Well, yeah, you can.
But you know, the funny thing is that, and a lot of people will say, I can't upload a video to my LMS. The only way they can get content into it is to put that video into a SCORM package and tell the LMS that this is an e-learning course.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And actually, I did a project very similar to that. And I do believe that in the end, everything was built in Articulate Storyline, even though some of them were videos and some of them were interactive e-learning modules. Yeah.
All right. What's number four?
Yeah. So obviously the third one is video. It's kind of your classic animations or videos, but anything of that ilk, right? And then number four is infographics. To me, this is a really important one because it's a really good way to get information to people quickly and helps us think about keeping the content really succinct and just to what they need and helpful. Yeah.
It's also a great way to make sure that you are properly contextualizing, you know, what's going in there. You do have to think about it because it is a visual design, which in turn leads back to making sure that you're actually, you know, supporting a learning objective as opposed to, again, just maybe doing information dumping.
Yes, yes. And in fact, that visual design is part of what's going to make that instructional design work so well, right? Because it has to be very usable as well. Yep. Mm-hmm. And so then the last one, which oftentimes people are surprised to see because they don't think of it, is podcasting. And in certain corporate environments, you see it used a lot. And in other ones, you don't see it used at all. And it really, really does depend on the use case, in my opinion. If the workers have a lot of windshield time, that's when they're in their cars driving to places, you see those organizations using podcasting a lot. And, you know, there's some other examples we give in the book. But, you know, but that's kind of the classic, you know, do they seem to have a lot of travel time that we can capitalize on? And then podcasting comes up a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we could do a whole entire episode on podcasting, which I think we will do soon. But this is another one that I'll just throw in my two cents on the technical side of it, right? Everybody, the term podcast gets spread across extremely broad. And so I have a tendency to get negative feedback from folks on podcasts because they scratch their heads and go, wait a minute. They think micro, they think short, and their favorite podcast is 2.5 hours long every single week.
Right? Yes.
And so then they go like, that's not micro. And it's like, well, just hold on. It's not about the length, right? It's about the delivery model, in my mind anyways. For me, it's about this idea of a podcasting ecosystem that you create within your corporation that functions the same way your little iTunes app grabs podcasts or your favorite podcatcher catches the latest version of it. The thing that's beautiful about podcasting is that you can't, that it is a cast and there's that subscription model. And you as a user, make the choice to pull that content towards you as opposed to having it shoved at you.
Yes, absolutely. And I think the other interesting thing to me also is when I hear people talking about, well, their favorite podcasts that are an hour or more. And I think, really, is someone going to be able to do that at work? You know, in full disclosure, for you guys, Brent and Chris, I got one of the ones that a snip from one of your recent idiotics that you had shared by email, and it was just 5 minutes, and it's been sitting on my to-do list now for 2 days because I haven't found time to listen to it, and it's 5 minutes. If it was 1 hour, I can guarantee you that I wouldn't have found time, right? And so I think when we're thinking about the workplace setting, like, I would be happy to use my, you know, my drive time to work in listening to a longer podcast. But if I'm actually at work, I want something that I'm going to listen to, say, between calls if I work in a call center, or, you know, while I'm driving from between clinics if I'm a medical device salesperson, or, you know, those sorts of things. So I think there are times when thinking about these in ways that are a little different from how we use them in our everyday lives is really powerful as well.
Indeed. Let's go to the chat and just ask folks, which of these five formats do you guys prefer? Do you have an option or one particular format that you either create in a lot or you prefer to use? I use all of them, so I'm biased across the board. Just curious to engage our plethora.
Mary Beth is making throwing in a question. Really, you're mentioning length of podcast. Ideal podcast length. We discuss ideal video length at a great deal. My response usually is the length is what it is needed to convey the topic. My feeling is most of the studies around, you know, ideal video length are typically based on people's behavioral use in YouTube, which is attention span for entertainment value, et cetera. And, you know, sometimes you get that 3 minutes kind of rule, et cetera, for videos. And I don't believe that those things have a relevance as a in terms of learning, because if the learning information is important, people are not just going to go, well, it's 3 minutes. I'm out of here, you know. So the length fits the... Let the sentence fit the crime? No, I mean, let the length fit the topic. So, 2 cents. So,
Brent, I've got a question for you on that, because I've heard that a lot, and I agree wholeheartedly for formal learning. But I often think that when you go to informal learning, people use some of those same standards. Just that, like, you're like, okay, I'm Googling, I need to find help on some pivot table in Excel. And if I see a whole lot of choices to choose from, I believe that some of those rules will still have significance for us, right? That I will probably choose the 4 minute or less one to start with. If it doesn't give me what I need, then I'll go forward from there. I'm curious what you think. I love talking about this with people. What do you think?
Yeah, so as far as in my personal experience, and from what I've seen other people do as well, I think there are a lot of variables that that the data doesn't take into consideration, right? So when you do you're right. Like your first thought is, well, I always do the prairie dogging in a cubicle farm, right? As step one, because nobody goes to Google first if you're sitting in a cubicle farm and you know somebody that's smarter than you is sitting right next door. So you pop your head over the top and you say, "Hey, Jane, can you help me out? And you know, can you give me the answer to this?" Because you'd rather talk to a human being anyways. Then you go to Google next and you look it up, unless you don't feel like standing right up, right? And then you get. You know, you get all that stuff coming back, or you go to YouTube and you look and you see, you know, maybe this short one will be good. But I think one of the most powerful things that people forget is that sometimes you're looking for a name, right? Or which one looks the most impressive. You're not necessarily looking for length first. It's like this one popped up first. It's got a really pretty thumbnail and the guy on the thumbnail looks very professional and the font is very professional. I'll bet they are spot on. And if you start it, and it looks to be really long, don't forget, everybody, you have the most powerful media e-learning feature in the whole entire world. It's called the fast forward and reverse button and the drag bar, right? These are interfaces that have stood the test of time that we often forget about as extremely powerful learning tools.
Mm-hmm. And I'm going to jump in and say, I know I said Brent, but I meant Chris, and I was looking at your video window the whole time. So I'm all sorry. Right, so, that was like, so you brought it up, Chris.
We often
I think part of it comes to curation, right? If you are looking within your corporate place for help, for information, for a task related to job, you're expecting that to be organized in a way that can help you solve that problem.
And good
so
quality.
Therefore, if it's solving the problem, if it's 7 minutes, it's because that problem needs 7 minutes, or if it's 3 minutes in that absolutely. Regard. So that's where I come from, that it's not like you're surfing the world and you've got 50 hits on something and you're trying to decide which one you're going to even start with. Probably there's one or maybe two things that, you know, you find because of that aspect of curation.
Yeah, because the amount is smaller too. Yeah. That makes sense. I love that. Very cool. Yeah. All right. shall I share my last piece here then?
Yep.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. So I'm getting faster at this.
Yeah. While you're bringing that up, Scott drops in a really interesting point. He says, "I can't stand how-to videos that don't narrate." And in a lot of instructional design conversations, you'll hear people say, "Well, if you have maybe text on the screen or something going on and narration, that could induce cognitive overload.
Yeah, and doubling effect and stuff like that. Yep.
Yeah. So it would be interesting. I mean, I guess for me, it's always how it's done. Is there that right balance and all of that? But I guess it depends on what it is. Sometimes it's so well done that it doesn't need narration, but I don't know. So it's interesting that you just dropped that in there. So I'd be curious to know if you have an example, Scott, if you've got a link to a YouTube or something, you could just like maybe drop it in there as a good example. That'd be cool.
Mm-hmm. In the meantime, we'll keep rolling with Carla.
Cool. Awesome. And you guys have been doing a better job than I am monitoring the chat. So if there's anything else that have come up, let me know. But the last kind of big thing I'm going to share today is if you take those four uses of microlearning and the five formats and you crisscross them, it actually brings up 20 ways you can use microlearning. And certainly there are some of these that are going to make, you know, probably be more common than others. But all of them exist, and we should think of all of them. So, for example, you could do a text-based resource and use it for preparation before a class, right? How often have we asked people to read a short article before they come, right? Or maybe we've got a video that's done in follow-up to the class. Hey, after the class is over, we're going to send a quick video. We'd love you to watch it. Or maybe that video is a performance support piece, or we're using an infographic as that support, right? And then, of course, as standalone, we've kind of already implied that all of those exist. So that's kind of my last big thing for today, which is these, if you take those together, you've got 20 ways you can use microlearning, and there's lots of options and lots of possibilities.
It's a great matrix, and it does it. It matches up perfectly the different combinations and uses of short form learning of some sort, right? This is something you and I see all the time in working with the Domino clients, is that, you know, the tool itself allows you to create all this stuff, right? And it doesn't matter. And so it's not, we're not just creating e-learning anymore. This is the great thing about our industry. Yes. And what we're doing, what we can provide to our learners and our users now has expanded exponentially and continues to expand into different media and different, you know, models and formats, and the mix and match that you can do to solve different business problems based on the audience is so huge. So to see a graphic like this too really drives that point home. So this is fantastic.
Mm-hmm. And I think there's also, if you're able to do this, value in overlapping these things, because depending on, you know, especially when it comes to performance support, what's the fastest way for someone to get there? Well, that might be contextually different. For some occasions it may be that they can grab the phone. Sometimes they're at a, you know, at an actual computer with a desktop, etc. So in a lot of these cases, there's value in you know, having things checking off, you know, multiple boxes to solve or to deal with the same things in some ways.
Yeah, and I think, you know, to your point, Chris, and I got it right this time, Chris, that it really is about that mix and match and really thinking about what we can do. And so, like I said, that's part of what gets me excited about Micro, because even though in many ways this isn't all that new, it's getting us thinking beyond just the e-learning and pulling it all together so that we can actually have the greatest impact on performance.
And there's also opportunities like, I mean, we're kind of breaking down into formal and informal with performance on the input. When you're thinking about that whole circle, you know, things that you're creating for formal can often also serve a purpose, you know, later on.
Yes.
If you're considering that kind of as part of your instructional design model, we're going to, as part of the formal learning, walk people through a set of steps for a task. Well, provide that again, you know, in another place for performance support. More bang for the buck, better chance that people will actually be able to successfully apply that then when they're actually on the job and not running this SCORM package in the LMS.
Yeah, you know, and to your point, I, you know, for the longest time, I used to think that, you know, what you design your e-learning and you design your performance support separately because, you know, different use cases, and, you know, that optimal design. But I have found more and more that it's not even entirely just about the budget and the best use of resources and creating the most value, which part of that is. But if you're already designing something that's so short, Why would you not then use it as just-in-time training, or take that last bit of text and make it also a job aid? It works. Yeah.
You've done 90% of the work already, and with just a little bit more, you're actually providing a huge value, especially for those. It doesn't matter if they got 10 out of 10 on all the quizzes in the LMS. If 2 months go by before they go to do a task, everybody's going to need a refresher on a lot of things.
So. Yes. And unfortunately, the LMS is not an easy place to read stuff.
When it comes to that world of performance support, the fewer clicks that get in the way, the faster that something can be solved. Heck of a lot of benefit there and value for sure.
And I'll add that I've got a number of clients who have told me that when they post something on their LMS, if you complete the course successfully, it's not on your dashboard anymore. You can't find it easily.
It goes off your history or your completions or something. I've had that confusion way, way back the first few times I was in an LMS and just running a thing for a client team. And I'm like, where did it go? Oh, you completed it. It's over here now. So,
Yes, it's interesting. You reached into that neuroscience conversation, Chris, with the overtime thing, right? This is why we know that this micro learning is important and multi-purposing your content is important and useful, because now we can actually support the theories around cognitive load and spaced repetition and all of that much better than we ever were able to in the past. So when you can space out that content over time, maybe you do present it to them all at once in one shot, but then you also drip out bits and pieces of it over time afterwards. Now you're starting to support the full learning process and not just creating training events. So my question to you, sorry to jump right into the next question. I just got to ask this before we run out of time. So how do we convince our either clients, or whether they're internal clients or if you're a consultant out there, to take advantage of this and to think differently? Because there are so many companies, so many clients out there that are still saying, you know what, this is great, but just create some training like you used to do, right? Give me an hour long seat time thing. You know, I know how to pay you for that. And I know what I'm expecting when I ask you to do it, right? So what can we do to help people start to see it? Or how have you done it? I mean, you obviously have a lot of clients on this side who either ask you to do it, or you've convinced them to at least give it a shot. How do we do that?
I think it really boils down to performance, right? And we've mentioned that a few times in this cast. You know, like if you talk to them about what behavior they're trying to change, and then you think a little bit about how those people are working at work, then I think those answers become a lot more obvious. I've got one client who did this amazing job. They surveyed their audience in advance and found stuff that they kind of already knew and we would know too, which is that their people are overworked. In their group, they're working at least 50 hours a week, and they feel like they don't have time for training. And so if you give them training, they actually don't have time for it anyway. And so even though they say they want lots of training, they actually say they will not use it if it was created for them. Mm-hmm. I don't think this is unique, right? It just happens to be that they actually got the data on their group.
Yeah.
So, right. So focus on performance, focus on what they really need, and then also start asking a little bit about, you know, what's the day at work like for those people? And hopefully not every organization is working 50 hours or more a week, but everybody's busy. If we were all sitting around eating bonbons, it just isn't happening, right? So I think that's the thing. Just ask what the performance need is, and then I think it just gets a lot clearer.
Chris, you were going to add something there.
I was going to make some joke about bonbons, but it's gone now. So anyway.
Oh, man. Well, you know what? I think this is a perfect spot to wrap up this conversation. What do you guys say?
Sure. I think so.
It's been absolutely fabulous. And thanks for bringing along those visuals. I think that my goodness, they're like micro learning components in and of themselves as part of our framework here today.
Good nuggets of knowledge.
And if we're mentioning micro learning, can I also mention that some of the folks in the chat may be familiar with this, but we've been doing little videos on LinkedIn, sort of our own practice, what we preach. And we're getting some really good views and responses from people. So I post a little video once every 2 weeks, never more than 3 to 4 minutes, something topical, sometimes micro learning, sometimes not, but always topical to the L&D space. And then we monitor and manage a conversation in the comments. So if anybody is interested in that, we're getting some pretty good traction with it. And so I just threw my LinkedIn in there. You can connect with me on LinkedIn. And like I said, we're posting a new video every 2 weeks.
And just so everybody knows, I sometimes act as her impromptu video producer and production specialist. So, you know, if you ever need videos done, you can just grab me in the hallway and say, hey, shoot this for me.
As I did at DevLearn. Yes.
Yeah. Well, speaking of events, you're also doing a workshop coming up at LSCon.
At Learning Solutions.
If you want to learn more and get their hands on and do a full day with Carla, you can totally do that too.
Yep.
Or you can buy her book, or you can do all three. Oh my gosh.
But we will be at Learning Solutions as well. And we've got the 1 day workshop there. And the stuff that we talked about today will be a part of that.
Mm-hmm. And speaking of Learning Solutions, we'll just let folks know, we are obviously as IDIODC going to be at Learning Solutions. In fact, we have a booth this year, and we're going to do the live IDIODC episode from the booth.
So if you
are going to Learning Solutions, check us out, join us. A bit of a sort of a free for all. We're going to ask folks to talk about their best and their toughest instructional design experience. A little micro learning aspect to it there. Hopefully we get lots of folks who want to share something and little pieces that we can all take away with turning it sort of into a group chat. We hope lots of folks will join us live there for it. So if you're going to Learning Solutions, check us out. And we'll put out info about that as we go along, as we get closer too. But we're down to the last, we're into the March now. So last few weeks before Learning Solutions.
Indeed we are. Well, we've got a little bit of music playing, so let's dance ourselves out of here. Carla, if you want to drop in some links, I think people would really appreciate that to find you more easily. Get those in there. And hey, folks, have a great week. Thank you again, Carla, for being with us. Always love chatting with you.
Thanks.
Thanks so much,
Bye,
Carla.
Bye, everyone.
We'll see you at Learning Solutions, and we'll see everybody next time.